Hello, you're with IndiaPostLive.com, India's first live conversation web TV portal. Well, we are in the middle of a highly polarized election, and Assam is reeling under ethnic violence. While several people have died, more than 30 people have been killed, several people have been displaced, there are still some people who are trying to make a positive impact using social media. Take a look.
Assam is bleeding again. Bodo militants have allegedly killed 32 persons in Kokrajhar, Chirong and Baksa districts. Hundreds have fled to the safety of relief camps. Army is out to restore order. The Bodo extremists, besides demanding a separate state for Bodo land, are also against Bangladeshi immigrants. On the ground, however, to tell a Bangladeshi from a local Muslim is a tricky thing. Political parties, as usual, have been finger-pointing and fueling passions. Amid all this insanity, a group of young Muslims from the state have chosen a different path. Instead of wailing in self-pity and victimhood, they have taken to peacemaking. This group was cobbled on the social networking site Facebook. Their online group is My Facts, which stands for Muslim Youths Forum Against Communalism, Terrorism and Sedition. Powered by the reach of the online media, the netizens of My Facts have stepped out of their virtual world.
All right, so we are going to talk about how some people have taken to social media to give that healing touch, that balm to people who need it the most. And right now with me in the studio, I have Shubhimol Bhattacharjee. Shubhimol Bhattacharjee is a cyber analyst and a cyber security expert. Thank you so much for joining us in this conversation. I also have with me Abir Fukan. Abir is an advocate in the Supreme Court, and of course he's been following the events in his home state very closely. Abir, thank you so much for joining the conversation. All right. Let me get your first reaction on this whole concept of My Facts that these young people have come up with.
I think this is a wonderful thing. Particularly, we always have thought that all the social media avenues are becoming more negative than positive. But this is one of the most positive examples that we are seeing. And as you mentioned about Facebook, now Facebook has just crossed 100 million users in India. It's the second in the world after the US. So out of this 100 million, if we can get 100 positive messages coming out or 100 positive usages, I think this is a great tool which social media offers. So I think this is a great initiative. But what I would also think is that, more people in Assam should connect, should be able to, see this initiative and use this, through the word of mouth and other avenues to be able to foster peace. Because while you mentioned Abir is from Assam, I also happen to be from Assam. And I happen to be from a place called Haflong, which was a, medley of different kinds of communities. In fact, I would have studied in my class with more than 27, 28 different communities.
That's right.
So all of us were great friends. We still maintain our friendship. And in this regular, great form of violence and killing each other, it's something that hurts us more than anything else. So if all of us can use this medium, which hitherto was unavailable, positively, I think that's a great thing, and we must commend those boys.
Right. Let's in fact go across to Aman Wadood. Aman Wadood is joining us on Google Hangout, and Aman is in fact the co-founder of My Facts. He is an advocate in the Guwahati High Court. Aman Wadood, welcome to the conversation.
Thank you, ma'am.
Tell us a little bit about what prompted you to start this group on Facebook. In fact, Aman, I would also like to tell you that I tried looking for it, and I think it's a closed group because I could not access it myself on Facebook. So tell us a little bit about that as well.
It's a closed group, actually. Initially, we started My Fact during the last BJP violence. So the liberal Muslim doesn't have any say. We do not belong from an organization. We do not belong to any political party, but we have a voice. The educated Muslims have a voice. So we made and the Facebook page came later. And now we communicate through Facebook pages. We have a full-fledged office now. We meet almost every day.
Right.
And we try to, you know, ponder about what's happening there and how to find a solution. How to find a solution to this continuous violence in BTAD. So that's how my fact. Now let's come to the hello.
Yes, I can hear you. I can hear you, Aman.
Now let's come to this to the main issue, which is violence. This is, you know, in social media, there are many people who are trying to give it a communal color. They are trying to say this is a clash between Bodos and Muslims. This is an illegal immigrant issue. It's nothing like that. It's not a clash between Bodos and Muslims. This is an election violence. I want to put that straight. This is an election violence. The election was on 24th. And Mr. Chandan Brahma, who was the BTR candidate, he also gave lots of provocative statements.
Yes.
During his
campaign.
Like statement like yahan pe bhukamp ho jayega agar hum haar jayenge, this sort of statement. 138.
No, of course. Brahma, at this time, of course, political parties have been making, you know, speeches, and we are seeing these kind of inflammatory speeches, Aman, all over the country, you know, where it seems that polity has kind of stooped to a new low. But let me, Aman, also get your thoughts on this. In 2012, which saw the largest, you know, case of mass migration of 4.5 lakh people were displaced, you know, mass displacement of people, again, similar ethnic violence. But Facebook and social media was in fact blamed for it, blamed for instigating that violence. What is interesting is that you are in fact using Facebook again. Surely.
See, you know, even today, if you see the train on Twitter, the top train was deport Bangladeshis. After the statement made by Mr. Narendra Modi, I am not blaming directly for this violence of Narendra Modi, but you know, this kind of abuse, this kind of provocation goes on social media, and it helps in, you know, increasing the violence. So what we try to do is that, even, you know, we try to spread this message of peace and love for the ways that we offend, and try to find a solution about this problem. And may I please finish my first point, what I was talking about is violence. On 38, the former minister and now MLA of DPR made a statement that Muslims didn't vote for us. And then that triggered violence.
All right.
That triggered violence.
All right. Aman.
Targeted killing of, now the toll has risen to 37, 50 is still missing. And now in social media,
Let me quickly get Abir's reaction on that. Let me quickly get Abir. Aman is calling it a totally politically motivated violence. What is your reaction on that, Abir?
See, it could be political. I don't think it's... Yeah, there is definitely a political undertone to the whole episode. And when in 2012 the violence happened, then the earlier question which you had put to us, that during that time there were a lot of allegations that Facebook and other social networking websites, there a lot of instigation happened which resulted in further violence. Well, my point to that is that, see, you expect facts to come before you. You inquiry commissions are set up every time there's a report. That's an immediate reaction.
Right.
This time, even the government has ordered a judicial probe. But nothing happens after that. We don't even know what the scope of the reference for that judicial probe is. So unless the facts come before the public will see this as a government which really is not concerned with what happens eventually to the victims. And you see, the violence, whether it's political, whether it's mindless, whether it's ethnic, one thing is certain, that there is a victim. You know, if all violence, there is a victim. And the concerns and the problems of these victims need to be redressed. Whether you call it ethnic, whether you call it political, it's immaterial. I think as the state, I mean, one expects the state to act immediately and restore law and order. There was a statement that normalcy is being restored. I mean, you hear that statement on a day when bodies are being fished from the rivers, right? and when houses are still being burned in the region. So we need something more. The same reaction every time there is a riot leads us nowhere. It takes us only backwards.
Right.
Right.
Let me get Ratnadeep Chaudhary's views on that. Ratnadeep is special correspondent with Tehelka, and he's been covering the Northeast. Ratnadeep, welcome to the conversation. You have just been hearing the three guests and what they talked about this entire issue. Now, you are a person who is there and who's kind of observing the events there. So, first of all, your first reaction to this group that Aman and his friends have set up, called My Facts, and how helpful can it really be to the people there? And secondly, the issue of political violence and the fact that this entire episode is actually only politically motivated.
Well, first let me come to the main debate that we are involved in terms of use of Facebook and social
yes,
media
absolutely.
During the riots. Now, if you are very correct to mention that in 2012 when the riots took place, and you know the entire social media, particularly the Facebook, was flooded with a lot of venom, and also with a lot of morph pictures and a lot of things which were basically to instigate a certain section of the society. Now this time around, the good news is that kind of venom is very less in social media, and initiative by Aman is a very good initiative. You know, there as Vimalda was pointing out that. There
Aman,
are more
one
and
second.
More people, even from Northeast, joining the social network.
Yes.
So you are getting that the 3G networks, the high speed internets are now reaching out to even suburban areas, the rural belts of this region. So you have more and more people joining it. So they are also getting to know what people from outside, youths, are viewing this violence as. So this is a good initiative in terms of interacting and sharing of minds, sharing of thoughts, and in this hour of crisis. But to take it, if I just juxtapose it into this in with the ground realities
exactly.
there in BTAD in Kokrajhar, I'm just back from there, from the scene of action this morning. Perhaps what is happening on social media really does not add up in terms of the ground realities for the victims
right,
at
exactly.
ground zero. For them, the issue is very local. For them, the issue, this violence, let me make it very clear, this violence is no ethnic violence. And the Assam government is trying to show it as an issue of law and order, issue of NDFB, Bodo rebels coming and hitting. Well, that has been on. I can come on record as a responsible journalist to say that these are targeted killings. And I would not go up to the level of saying, claiming that it is an ethnic cleansing, as a lot of people would say, but I would obviously come on record and say yes, because I have been in ground zero, I've met people, these are targeted killings, which could have been averted if the government was sincere. And so, perhaps now social media should be used in terms of, putting the question to the political parties who are involved in the poll battle. These elections are highly polarized. Even elections in Assam has been highly polarized this time.
Aman,
and perhaps, people are now connected through internet, through satellite television. They are also, somebody's lecturing or addressing a public rally in Kanyakumari, a person sitting in Kokrajhar can listen to it. And so, it kind of at times helps in it kind of creates impacts in the mind of people in
right.
communities who are at treasure edge.
In fact, this issue has come to the, is a headline issue during the elections. Aman, let me get your reaction on that. You've been wanting to say something. Ratnadeep just said that it is targeted killing.
I completely agree with him. This is a targeted killing. This is an administration-sponsored violence, state-sponsored violence. And I just 2 points I would like to make about what Ratnadeep said. He is absolutely true. But being in My Facts, apart from being a Facebook group, we also have our members in BTAD who are walking in the ground.
Right.
Last violence, we went there, we worked for them, for the victim, we gave them legal help and every kind of help. This time also, we will go there, our members are there, and we will try to help in every way possible. Also, try to find the real solution. And I will tell you what the real solution is.
No, you have talked of submitting petitions to the government. You have talked of the government making an inquiry, a judicial inquiry. But like Kabir was just telling us, we really don't get anything out of them, do we?
That's exactly my point is. Now from 1993, not only Muslims, this is not violence for 1996 on Santhal, 200 people killed, more than 2 lakh people displaced, 1998 again on Adivasis, more than 80 people killed, more than 1 lakh displaced, but there is nothing for justice. I mean, this BJD is, you know, under utter lawlessness, no civil administration, no law and order, nothing. So what do you expect? In 2003, the Bodo militant, they gave up arms, but yes. 90% of the arms were not, they didn't surrender.
Yeah, only 10%, yes. Yes, these things have come
just
out.
What do you expect when there are so many illegal arms? Paramilitary forces can't do anything, police can't do anything. Everything are controlled by illegal arms. So obviously there will be violence. This is, unfortunately, this won't be the last time. Violence will keep happening. Government will keep telling them to seize the arms, but they do nothing. Nothing whatsoever to seize those arms. Last time they told that we will seize arms, what they did, government should come on white paper and this BTM is over. But alliance of the Congress Party, why are they not seizing the arms? Last time BTM MLA was arrested for having illegal arms, but still, BTN areas full of illegal arms, sophisticated arms, and they are using the same arms to kill non-close people.
Yes, Aman, let me ask this question to Shubhi Malda. But before that, all of you, please send us your comments on this very interesting conversation we're having and something that is back in the headlines, unfortunately. Send us your tweets, hashtag IndiaPostLive, and send us your comments. All you have to do is log on to www.indiapostlive.com. We are waiting for your tweets and your comments on the issue. You can also join us live on this conversation if you have any points to make. I just wanted to ask you something. Of course, while both Ratnadeep and Aman have said that it's very positive, even you said it's a positive thing. But also this time, we've had pictures of the mutilated bodies of children being circulated on the social media. Now, that is not a good thing, right? So while on one hand, it is a positive thing, it also has, it is also capable of stirring very violent passions.
Yeah, I think, as a practice, this should never be allowed. And
right.
We also have laws to take away such kind of content.
Hmm.
Now, who are posting those pictures?
Hmm.
I think, we need to really check on them.
Hmm.
And government should proactively get involved in this.
Hmm.
As they got involved in the last spate of violence,
hmm.
where actually they took down 320 odd, content related sites.
Hmm.
Of course, many of them were also not related to it. But what is very important, I still want to go back to what Ratnadeep made about the disconnect among, many of
exactly.
us in the social media and the people on the ground there.
Hmm.
It's all, I think, and I made a big Facebook posting 2 days back where I have a lot of reactions also from some eminent people from the region that, why can't you take the illegal arms out? Every surrender ceremony that happens in the Northeast or maybe in Assam isn't done seriously. It is a kind of a show, it's a kind of a ceremony that, some few people are giving, but most of the arms are behind. So why can't we take a serious approach on that? And, why can't there be a check and balance between the state and the central government? That we really need to take the arms out, because each of these incidents of violence, the previous incidents of violence, the macabre way in it was done. That time the state government, with all its forces should have gone, raided every house and taken these illegal arms out. After all, they are not dumped in some this thing. These are all in houses.
A
certain
Bodo
MLA was, if he was moving with arms, what is the current status of that particular case against him? He's going scot-free. So, this is the problem. If you are using, see, the whole problem here this time is absolutely I would say magnified, because arms are available at easy with one particular community. And the fight is, as rightly pointed out, is not only a fight between the Bodos or the Muslims and all.
Yes.
Consistently, there has been problems going on. Mm. Many other communities have also faced it. So it's a kind of an armed group of people who have all kinds of blessings and, you know, to whom everyone tries to look the other way, people in responsible positions, compared to people who are very much unarmed, you know, the daily laborer, workers and all. Now, isn't it something, you know, shameful that, you know, a state which where 30% of the police forces are, you know, protecting with escort vehicles and, you know, bodyguards,
right,
the politicians and the bureaucrats can't protect people who work sincerely to earn their lives? So I think, you know, this is a bigger social problem, and putting all the blame to illegal migrants and all is just, you know, bogus activity. It's not only a question of illegal migrants. Illegal migrants are spread all over the state. Maybe the pressure on the land in that part might be a little bit more, but that doesn't solve the problem. The problem lies in trying to unarm all these, you know, people. I said in my Facebook post that why don't you name and shame all these fellows who are having arms? Of course, it's not name and shame. It's actually illegal. So they are actually punishable under law. So this is a big exercise that the government has to take. Otherwise, giving NIA or anybody doesn't solve.
But, you know, we see a lot of, I mean, you know, when something like this happens during election time, we see a lot of political rhetoric. Mamata Banerjee has said that Modi has instigated violence in Assam.
Yeah, yeah.
Omar Abdullah has talked of Assam. Yeah. I mean, everybody seems to be talking about Assam right now, Abhi.
Yeah, but see, the problems relating to this region are not that easy to comprehend
and
understand.
It's very complicated.
I mean, perhaps the state has been failing us for decades now.
Absolutely.
So a minister, a chief minister of another state is in no position to understand these issues. Forget about commenting on these issues.
The so, tribal ethnicity, the multi-ethnicity, as you talked about, you know, so many different kinds of people living in, you know, in one state. And
right. So everybody claims rights. And every,
yes,
the moment somebody claims rights, the government steps in to pamper them, give them some autonomous council, or give them this and that. That only ends up pampering the community. I mean, ultimately, you can't multiply and divide, you know, and that will only create the, I mean, you divide the region and you multiply the problems. That's what's been happening.
Aman, let me get your views on this. We are more or less agreed on this larger issue of illegal arms. How do you think social media, let me get back to, you know, the balm, you're trying to create a balm for the people, affected people of Assam. How do you think social media can help in targeting or in taking some action on this issue of illegal arms?
In social media, we can just raise the awareness, we can just put the things straight.
Hmm.
We can just put the thing, at the end of the day, you know, it's the responsibility of the government to seize these arms. True? And in BTAD, you know, if you ask Ratnadi, he knows where, 70% are non-Bodos.
Hmm.
70% people are non-Bodos. But there is no equal democratic right for everyone. 30% of the people who are Bodos are getting, you know, 34 seats are reserved for them. There are 46 seats in the PTC council seats.
But the NDFB, itself is fractured. The leadership itself is fractured.
Just, I'm coming to that.
Okay.
I'm coming to that.
Yeah.
46 seats, 6 are nominated, 34 are reserved for ST. That is the Boros and the Rawas. And Rawas is a very, very small amount of people, Rawas, generally for the Boros.
Right.
And what about the 70% people? There is no equal political representation. And even no democratic rights. You cannot vote on your choice. You are threatened, you are killed, you are massacred. Excuse me. There is a genocide if you don't vote for the party.
Aman, Ratnadeep has a point to make. Aman, one second. Ratnadeep has a point to make. One second. Let me just get Ratnadeep's view on this. Ratnadeep, yeah, tell us.
I'm just adding up to what Aman is saying. I think even if we seize all the illegal arms in Bodoland, that is not going to solve the problem.
It's an issue of vote bank politics?
The need of the hour is to look at the Bodoland Accord signed in 2003 with the
Peace
Bodo Liberation Tigers.
Exactly.
I think the Bodoland Accord needs to be looked at once again. He's talking about political representation here. That is a very big issue. And you know, the violence, the root of this violence, the renewed violence, I would say, lies in the Bodoland Accord. And it was the NDA regime. I'm not kind of, you know, targeting NDA, but it was an NDA regime. Bodoland was the, you know, the, this accord was a pet project of the then Home Minister L. K. Advani. And now, you know, Congress is trying to politicize it, trying to say that, you know, BJP's hate speeches. But the fact remains is that, Modi's hate speeches perhaps has nothing to do directly with what has happened in Assam. But in the fallout that this debate has started and it has become a national debate, now Mamata Banerjee is reacting, Omar Abdullah is reacting. This is going to politicize, this is going to create impact in the minds of people who are already traumatized, in the minds of various ethnicities there who are sharply divided, a huge ethnic distrust is there, and the national political leaders are making things more worse for the people at ground zero.
Ratnadeep, the chief minister has said categorically that there is no question of a separate state, but he has assured that the minorities would be protected. And also the BJP appears to be saying that it would be thinking of, the issue of statehood. How has that, how is that playing out there on the ground?
See, BJP for a long time has been playing with this sensitive card of separate state with the Bodos.
Right.
You see, this 2003 accord has come. Before that also, if you look at, if not BJP, there are a lot of organizations like RSS and its, a lot of similar organizations have been active in that area. And there has been a fight within the Bodo society on religious lines. Because if you look at the history of NDFB, if you look at the leadership of NDFB, NDFB leaders are very much influenced by Christianity. So, on religious line, the fight within the Bodo society is there. And let me tell you one thing. Last time during the riots in 2012, the Bodo society, it seems, irrespective of whether they support the armed movement or not, were kind of a cohesive unit. This time around, a lot of people within the Bodo society who have also condemned this kind of violence, because this kind of violence also kind of corners the Bodo society. There
okay, let me, Ratnadeep, let me get back to Aman's... Let me please get back to Aman's initiative. Let's, the MyFax initiative. First of all, it is a closed group. Do you agree that it should be made open so that more and more people can actually contribute and write and the message can be? Please tell Aman Wadud whether it should be made an open group now.
Yeah, I think, we should make it open because, in a closed group, you can't spread peace. So we should make it open, but actually, we...
How many of you are involved in this right now, Aman? How many of you are involved in this group?
I think now it's about 2,300 people, but active members are around 500-600.
All
so
right.
We obviously try to do our bit on internet, but our focus is on internet, online, on Facebook. On
Let me get Shubhimalda's view on that, please. Let me get Shubhimalda's view
we
on
can't
that.
Can't solve problem.
I think, Aman, obviously, as you said, it must be made open. It will get much more views. And you are doing a great job because, first and foremost, by expressing the views, most of the people are also possibly taking the sting away from the anti-movement that can happen across in other parts of the state. And as you are aware, in Barakwali and all yesterday in the Bund, there was also some sporadic violence. So this is a great step, that if people are able to coalesce together through your... network into something positive and give a clean, positive message, I think you are doing a greater good because violence can erupt in any other part of the state. Secondly, I think an effort parallelly also should be made that, how to reach out also to the other side and, maybe people from the other side would also actually try and come and
communicate. Like Ratnadeep said, that there are people in the Bodo communities also who are condemning
absolutely.
This violence.
So I think, we should all get champions, like you from other side, from almost all the communities and try and see that, peace is attained, faster and then the people who are suffering, they can be actually given the right relief.
Right. We have another conversation coming up. So we will have to continue this conversation through comments from people. I invite all of you to send us your comments. I will come back to you for your last comments. But all of you, please continue the conversation with us on our website, www.indiapostlife.com. Please tweet us your comments. We will carry on the conversation online, of course. But it is time for our next. So quickly, Aman, your last comments as the founder of MyFax.
We made this closed group because in open group there's so much of abuse. Our group, we don't allow any kind of abuse.
That is a hazard. Yes.
That is one reason why there's a closed group. And I would like to make on the issue most importantly because there is no justice. That is why violence is going on. This time, we have demanded an SIT should be formed.
Yes.
Headed by a Supreme Court judge.
Okay,
so
let me.
That the political, the conspirator should be prosecuted and justice should be done. If justice is not done, this kind of violence will keep going on and on and on.
Let me take Abir's last comments on what he has just said. He's talked of setting up an SIT.
Right. No, that's an excellent thought, and it's an excellent initiative at the very right time, I would say. But the thing is, this needs to be taken through to its logical end. You see, unless, I mean, the demands are made day in and day out, and the government promises this and that, but we don't see any implementation of those promises, right? So, I mean, I think the group needs to be there. Needs to be around till the time all these demands are not just accepted, they are implemented. What the government promises is ultimately delivered. They should be around till then.
Right.
Right. Because, I mean, you see a lot of groups, a lot of communities giving their reactions whenever these incidents happen. And the government have their own way of giving their promises. But, I mean, we need to be around to ensure that that these promises are delivered.
Your last comment, sir, on this initiative?
No, I think this is a good initiative, and knowing, you know, Aman as one of the most prolific
yes.
Twitter guys
and
for years.
Yes.
Yeah, and of course, he's also vociferous. But,
yes.
You know, this is a good step. I would think,
yes.
you know, a lot of more people should get. And I would also tell him that, you know, please open it up even for abuses.
Yes.
Because, you know, even when the abuses come out, you know, you are healing a lot of, you know, sentiments that
ultimately,
has
it's
grown
a greater
up
good.
In other areas.
Ratnadeep, your final comments. As a journalist on the ground, this entire initiative that has happened, and you know, eighth phase tomorrow, polling, and then we just have one more to go. We are finally coming to an end. Do you see this issue, tapering down?
This issue will taper down because now there would be political pressure as well to bring a sense of peace in the region. Coming quickly to the issue of using Facebook, I think Aman and his team has done a very good work, and I would request him to make it open. Let
yes.
the abusers come in, but then let there be a two-way conversation.
Absolutely.
But I think the biggest debate should not be about insurgency arms. Insurgencies and arms are a fallout of the type of politics that has been on in Northeast India post-independence. The question should be on politics, politicians, and the political decisions that they take. Because
right.
if today BPF goes out of power in BTC, might be the person and the party they would be choosing would also be somebody who has gone to that stature by the means of arms.
All right.
I don't want
Thanks
to take
so
a person,
much.
But
Thanks so much,
so,
Ratnadeep.
This entire situation should be changed.
All right. Thanks so much, Ratnadeep. In a few minutes, we will have to start our next conversation. But all of you are invited to carry on the conversation. I'll tell you once again, just log into www.indiapostlive.com. Send us your tweets, your comments on this entire issue. I would like to thank Ratnadeep. Of course, thank Aman. Thank him for the initiative and also thank him for joining us in the conversation with your comments. Thanks to both of you who have joined us on Google Hangout. I would like to thank Suvimal Bhattacharji and also Abir Phukan for taking out the time to join us in the conversation. Thank you so much.
Thanks.